Of the apostles. Saul, still breathing murderous threats against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, that if he should find any men or women who belonged to the way, he might bring them back to Jerusalem in chains. On this journey, as he was nearing Damascus, a light from the sky suddenly flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" He said, "Who are you, sir?" The reply came, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, for they heard the voice but could see no one. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him to Damascus. For 3 days he was unable to see, and he neither ate nor drank. There was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias, and the Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias," he answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight, and ask at the house of Judas for a man from Tarsus named Saul. He is there praying, and in a vision he has seen a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him, that he may regain his sight." But Ananias replied, "Lord, I have heard from many sources about this man, what evil things he has done to your holy ones in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to imprison all who call upon your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for this man is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before Gentiles, kings, and children of Israel. And I will show him what he will have to suffer for my name." So Ananias went and entered the house, laying his hands on him. He said, "Saul, my brother, the Lord has sent me, Jesus, who appeared to you on the way by which you came, that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately things like scales fell from his eyes, and he regained his sight. He got up and was baptized, and when he had eaten, he recovered his strength. He stayed some days with the disciples in Damascus, and he began at once to proclaim Jesus in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God. All who heard him were astounded and said, "Is not this the man who in Jerusalem ravaged those who call upon him in his name, and came here expressly to take them back in chains to the chief priests?" But Saul grew all the stronger and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus, providing that this is the Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Go out to all the world and tell the good news.
Go out to all the world and tell the good news.
Praise the Lord, all you nations. Glorify him, all you peoples.
Go out to all the world and tell the good news.
For steadfast is his kindness toward us, and the fidelity of the Lord endures forever.
Jesus appeared to the 11 and said to them, "Go into the whole world and proclaim the gospel to every creature. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Whoever does not believe will be condemned. These signs will accompany those who believe. In my name they'll drive out demons, they'll speak new languages, they'll pick up serpents with their hands. If they drink any deadly thing, it'll not harm them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover." The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I want to offer Sister Marie St. Paul a blessed birthday. And I'm sorry, a blessed feast day. Feast day. Yesterday and in the coming years, we ask St. Paul to bless her, bless all the sisters, bless all of us. We should be praying to St. Paul today in a special way. I am ever mindful that the Church in its wisdom, Christ's authority on earth, really designate a particular day for us to celebrate a particular saint, that indeed our Lord will honor that saint with great intercessory graces, and that we should specifically ask of that saint our graces, our intentions that day. So when I was listening to Sister proclaim the first reading, the two options are basically the same. Ananias. And I really never thought. I always liked it, and you guys have probably figured this out before. I really do like to try and humanize, not Christ by any means, right? Because he was God. But the human nature of everyone in Scripture besides Jesus, because they were human, we tend to think because they're in Scripture, the Gospels, of great saints, fathers of our church, especially the apostles, that, you know, somehow they're beyond human, right? But no, they were very human, right? So Ananias. Right, so God's talking to Ananias. Jesus is talking to Ananias. And, well, but wait a minute, Lord. There may be something you don't know here about this guy, right? I mean, that's pretty humorous, right? That's pretty humorous. And, of course, it just, our Lord doesn't think anything of it. And when you run into situations like that, where there's no repercussion, the Lord knows Ananias is. And so it's not a big deal. It's not a big deal for this question. Well, Lord, there may be something you don't know, right? But I had a chuckle when that thought popped into my head. And I dare say we probably think that way once in a while. You know, Lord, there's something you don't know about my life, right? Well, no, that's not true, right? So the conversion to St. Paul, I dare say none of us have experienced the conversion to St. Paul. Maybe conversion similar to St. Paul. His was pretty dramatic. I had to laugh this morning. I was reading somebody posted on social media about the conversion to St. Paul, and they were complaining. He was saying that people were complaining about this particular post about the conversion of St. Paul. And he, in explaining it, talked about how Paul got knocked off his horse. And I thought for sure that people were going to complain to this guy that, you know, Paul wasn't on a horse, he didn't get knocked off his horse. We just know that, you know, he got knocked to the ground and he was blinded and all of a sudden. But it turned out to be something completely different, right? Paul's conversion was very dramatic, very dramatic. And I dare say that some of us may have experienced some conversions like St. Paul. But I dare say that most of us in our lives have experienced conversions more like St. Augustine. I always use Augustine, right? Lord, make me chaste, just not to death, right? This whole idea of grappling with our change in life, right? Kind of like wanting to hold on to our prior life as our Lord is grabbing us and pulling us, the Holy Spirit's pulling us, kicking and screaming into this new life, the new wineskin, right? But in spite of that, And obviously Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, goes out and does dramatic things and suffers. I mean, I guess next to Jesus, I don't think there's anyone who suffered more than Paul. What he endured in his life is beyond, comprehension, it seems like. As a matter of fact, actually, we should really meditate on the sufferings of St. Paul in our journey. Someone once said to me, after watching the Passion of Christ, and I had just watched it, I was one of the last people to see the Passion of Christ. I was in a seminary at the time, and I was afraid to go see the Passion of Christ because I was going kind of like through a dark night of the soul, and I was going through a lot of things, praying for martyrdom every day, thinking, you know, my Lord, you're going to condemn me because we're not doing near enough of the babies, the mass murder of the babies during that period of time. Terry Schiavo was being murdered. You know, St. John Paul II was dying. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on. And I was going through, and I said, the last thing I really need is to go see the Passion of Christ, and I put me over the edge. But then I eventually went to see it. Somebody, after I said, well, I finally saw the Passion of Christ, they said, you know, that scourging scene, you know, and everything that Jesus went through, it really was proof that he was God. And he suffered that much. He had to be God to endure that suffering. Now, I didn't give it a second thought. That's why I know it was the Holy Spirit. Right? It's not like I had thought about it before, but I immediately responded to what this person said was, no, I think it shows how much we as humans can endure if we're united to Christ. Right? It's not a proof of him being God. Right? The resurrection is proof of him being God, but not the suffering. Right? And Paul's an example of the suffering that we can, what we can endure in our lives if we're united to Christ. But in spite of that, and this is really the crux of what I wanted to talk about today, Paul was not impeccable. As much as he had this dramatic conversion like none other, he wasn't impeccable. I mean, clearly he struggled with a lot of things. I get in trouble once in a while as I say this, but I don't care. You'll never convince me that Paul did not struggle with jealousy of Peter, right? He absolutely did. And he struggled with some other things in his life. Why? Because he was struggling to be a saint. He wanted to be a saint. And he was on the road to sainthood, but he was human and he struggled. Regardless of the effusion of the Holy Spirit, regardless of the great graces that he was given, he still had some struggles, right? All of them had struggles. Augustine was quite honest about his struggles. And of course, he had a story that was not quite as dramatic as St. Paul. St. Paul was murdering Christians. And I think this is also a lesson for us today. When Jesus calls Paul out, right, he says, why are you persecuting me? Why are you persecuting me? When we criticize the Pope, when we criticize any aspect of the church, whether it be the validity of the ordinary form of the Mass, whether it be the validity of the Second Vatican Council, whether it be the validity of the election of the Pope, whatever, the Pope himself, we are persecuting Christ. We need to get our mind around that. Somebody once said to me, and I think I pointed this out in another homily, and I'm sorry for repeating myself, you know, somebody once said to me that there were certain aspects of the ordinary form Mass, that's the Mass we celebrate here, the certain aspects of it that are satanic. And I took it as a direct insult to me. You're telling me the Mass I celebrate every day has certain aspects that are satanic? And this woman was a doctor of theology. And she could not understand how I took that personal. Can't separate a priest from his Mass. We're kidding ourselves if we think that we can separate Christ's church from Christ, bridegroom and bride, and the two shall be one. They are one. One is Christ with his church through the Eucharist. The church is one with Christ. We persecute the church. We criticize the church. We're criticizing Christ. There's no getting around that. And I really think we need to come to grips with that. So St. Paul struggled. They all struggled. St. Augustine struggled. St. Francis struggled. They all struggled. Some of them seemed to have very few struggles in their lives. They struggled. Believe me, they all struggled. On the journey to sainthood, to live as saints and die as saints. That's why we should never get discouraged in our journey towards the New Jerusalem. I've said many times, we need to be resolutely determined on a journey to Jerusalem and never get discouraged by our struggles. But at the same time, in our struggles, in our sinfulness, in our weakness, we need to recognize that we're nothing without Christ's mercy. And Paul understood that more than anything else. He realized in the beautiful talk that he gave about him being the least, right? That he was murdering Christians and that Christ was merciful to him. Paul sensed that he received greater mercy than anyone. That may or may not be true, but that doesn't matter. We need to see all of ourselves as being the greatest recipient of Christ's mercy. That Christ has given us more mercy than he's given anyone else. Anyone else. And only by the grace of that mercy go anyone else. Let's never be discouraged by our failings, our sins. Let's always be thankful for Christ's mercy. But never, ever, ever take that mercy for granted. Always giving thanks to Christ for his boundless mercy. The light of Christ shines in the world of darkness to transform, heal, and save. With grateful joy we pray that Holy Mother Church would zealously proclaim the truth of Christ to the world in need of a saving power. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The conversion of all legislators and leaders who promote the culture of death. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the salvation of the world, especially all those whose hearts are hardened against our Lord and his church, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for the grace to be receptive to the Lord's invitation to conversion, repentance, and new life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for all the holy souls in purgatory, we pray to the Lord. For an end to the conflict in Ukraine and Israel, and for peace to reign in this country throughout the world, we pray to the Lord.
Lord.
And for Sister Marie St. Paul on her feast day, through the intercession of St. Paul the Apostle, we pray to the Lord.
Lord.
Great God of glory, you call St. Paul to preach the gospel to the nations by faith in your power to save. Hear our prayers and draw all to yourself. Christ our Lord. Bless you, Lord God of all creation, for your goodness, you have received the bread we offer you from the earth, work of human hands. Come for us the bread of life. Bless you, Lord God of all creation, for your goodness, that we see the wine we offer you for the vine, working from the end to become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brethren, my sacrifice of your love may be sent to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands for the praise and glory of His name, for our good and the good of all His holy church.
As we celebrate the divine mysteries, O Lord, we pray, may the Spirit fill us with that light of faith with which He constantly enlightened the apostle, blessed apostle Paul, for spreading of your glory through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty God. You, eternal shepherd, do not desert your flock, but through the blessed apostles watch over and protect it always, so that it may be governed by those who have appointed shepherds to lead in the name of your Son. So with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, make humble prayer and petitions of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church, be pleased to grant your peace, to guard, unite, and govern throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Lord, John, our Bishop, all those who hold to the truth and honor the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your souls and the hope of health and well-being. eternal God living in truth, in communion with those whose memory venerate especially the glories of the Virgin Mary, Mother of our God, and Lord Jesus Christ, the blessed Joseph, her spouse, blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter, Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, Jude, Linus, Cletus, Lemon, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysostom, John, and Paul, Cosmas, and Damian, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers of all things, we may be defended by your protecting and helping. Therefore, Lord, we pray and graciously accept this oblation of our service, that in your home family order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless and honor and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritually acceptable, so may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father. Giving you thanks, he sent the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, the supper was ended. He took this precious chalice, this holy and venerable hand, and once more giving you thanks, he said to bless, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out in you and for many for forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
And for us,
therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of blessed passion, resurrection, and the glorious ascension of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants, your holy people, offer to your glorious mansion for the gifts you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings in a screening, kindly countenance, and to accept them as one true belief, to accept the gifts of your servant, even the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our Father, and faith in the offering of your high priest, a holy sacrifice of spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask, O Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angels, your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, through all of us who through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, life, and peace. To us also, your servants who know sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Marcus, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Petra, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints and good us and beseech you with their company. Not when our marriage and grant your part to Christ, our Lord, whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through them, with them, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, and in you, Holy Spirit. await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostle, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, not in ourselves. By the faith of your church and grace, you grant your peace in you, the importance of your will, live and reign forever and ever. Peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to suffer the Lamb. Lord, I live by faith in the Son of God who has loved me and given himself up for me.
Body of Christ.
Let us pray. This sacrament we have received, O Lord our God, stir up in us the fire of charity with which the Apostle Paul burned ardently in the poorest concern for all the churches. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorify the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael the Archangel.